All right, let's get to it, Lance, because I know you're pretty hot about this. The last-second touchdown by Jamal Williams. Dennis Allen had to apologize for it. Players said they did it on their own. Go ahead.
Okay, so let me preface everything that I'm getting ready to say with, I understand the frustration from Arthur Smith. He's a coach whose job is potentially on the line. His team showed up and played well really early, had some big plays, but for the rest of the game, chose not to show up and got their butts kicked. So while you're down already 24 points and throwing the football late with your third string quarterback in the game, you give up an interception, a long return, and then you want to get mad that your defense doesn't stop somebody. Now, I understand it looked like it was going to be a kneel down, but get over it. Like, it's the Falcons versus the Saints, and we want to run the score up. I know if I was the head coach, I probably wouldn't even have gotten in victory formation. I would have run another offensive play from a regular formation, and because we have the better team, and we proved that, and we shouldn't have lost that first game. But enough about Arthur Smith and the Atlanta Falcons. If I'm Dennis Allen and I tell my team that I want them to take a knee, but they say, hey, we have a guy that's busted his tail the entire season and all of us want him to score a touchdown, I'm probably just going to be like, go ahead and do it. I'll take the flag. He said no. They chose to do it anyway, which in my opinion, as a former player, I love it. I love Jameis. He's going in the game for one play. It's a kneel down. Nah, I'm not doing that. I'm handing the ball off to my guy. I want him to score a touchdown. And the situation after the game where Arthur Smith approached DA and was angry, who cares? He's not your player. He's a coach from the other team, from the hated rival. Nobody cares what he thinks. I don't care about that. So for DA to go in and essentially throw his whole team, but specifically his backup quarterback under the bus, I don't like it. And I guarantee you to a man, there's not a single player that's going to say, you know what? Jameis is wrong for that. DA's right. He should have told everybody what happened. Like, no, man, you're the head coach of the football team. You want to earn something of as far as credit or trust goes with your guys moving forward, you fall on that sword. You know what? We wanted to get our guy a touchdown, and you can handle that situation behind closed doors. He chose not to do that, and I guarantee you, all the players are going to feel some type of way about it. Now, I don't know if it's a situation where the locker room is completely lost. I think we played a great game today. Offensive, defensively, special teams. I mean, we looked really, really good. So we were a prepared team. And obviously, we wanted to win this game. So I can't tell you that he's completely lost the locker room. But I do know that there are situations that have happened this season where things have not looked great and people have been thrown under the bus. And I know that was not something that happened a lot in my day. And I don't like to speak a lot about that. I don't like to be the guy that's talking about how things were when I played. But we didn't see that a lot. We saw that a lot this year. It's not normal, and it's not what great teams do.
Lance, let me follow up. Back when you played, if the players would have defied Sean Payton and he would have said kneel down, that's my bigger question. Is it more, I get it, we're in an age of player empowerment. But when Dennis tells the team to do something, and they say, nah, we're good. We're going to do what we want to do. What does that say about their respect level for the head coach? I get it. It was in the moment. I get it. They wanted their guy to get a touchdown. But overall, is it a bigger issue as far as having respect for Dennis Allen when he told them to do something and they just, to a man, blew him off?
Well, I can't tell you what would have happened if Sean was the coach. But I can guarantee you if Drew Brees walked into the huddle and said, hey, we're going to get this guy a touchdown, every single player would have been like, okay, we'll deal with it together. Like that's what I think. I mean, I can't tell you if they respect him or not. Like from the outside, you can say, oh my gosh, this team is so disrespectful. They don't listen to their coach. But it was one play in a game that was already decided by a lot, and they did it for a great reason. It wasn't like it was just some situation where they're like, man, forget this guy. We're on another page or we're doing something completely different. The game was already decided. It's against your rival, and you have a guy that's been with you and played and busted his tail the whole season, and they wanted to get him in the end zone. That, to me, is a justifiable offense. I'm sorry. And I guarantee you, DA could be steaming in the moment, but at the end of the day, he's got to understand he's human, and he should love his players and want the best for them. So I can't tell you what would have happened if Sean was the coach. I can't tell you if they would have defied him, but I'm telling you, they did it for a great reason. And to me, Jameis kind of spearheading that just kind of tells you the type of guy that he is, the type of teammate that he is, and how selfless he is to want to do something great for a guy that's been so great for this team.
All right, for now, the third straight year the Saints have missed the playoffs. What do they do now going forward? What changes do you think needs to be made on this team, on the staff, in order for them to get back to their winning ways and make the playoffs next year?
Well, I mean, look, we're talking a lot about this, the last play of the game, and we talked, Sharif and I have talked a lot this week about finishing the season with two wins and the organization, the coaches, Mickey Loomis, everybody being able to talk about this team is ascending. They're going in the right direction and see how strong we finished. But to me, it kind of sugarcoats or covers up the fact that this team is not in a great position. We've got some really, really good players. We've got some talented players. I just don't think a team that had such high aspirations this year, we finally got a quarterback. We're playing with the easiest schedule in a long time, and we still don't make it to the playoffs. To me, it's got to be disappointing for everybody. But it really, the way that we finished, winning these last two games and then having to hope that specific teams lose, it's never a world that you want to live in. And it's kind of ironic that the one team or one of the teams that we needed to lose was a team that we were up 17-0 on the road early in the season. They end up winning and sticking a nail in our coffin. But some of the issues that I've got in my mind moving forward for this team is the cap situation. Obviously, we're in cap hell. We've been in cap hell for years now. We continue to kick the can down the road with no long-term plan. It's kind of scary. Our offensive line issues. We can't keep guys healthy. We're aging on defense. We have a lack of consistent pass rush. Carl Granderson was great this year. Brian Brzee was great this year. But outside of those guys, there's nobody that has really scared people. I know Cam Jordan dealt with injuries all year, and I'm never going to count him out. But it's scary to finish the season the way that we did and then allow an organization. I haven't, you know, we haven't had the postseason press conference yet, but I can almost guarantee you that some of the things that are going to be said are, well, we finished strong. We feel like we're going to be moving forward in the right direction. We've got our quarterback. The right people are in the building. I mean, all the things that teams say after they come up just short, after, you know, and they win a couple games in a row to end the season. But it's to me, there are bigger issues, and it's got to start from the top and work its way on down.
Lance, you are on fire and amazing tonight. We could probably do this for the whole half-hour show, but we've got to wrap it up, and that pains me to say that. So really quickly, yes or no, and then we've got to say goodbye. Is Pete Carmichael back? Is Alvin Kamara back? Is Michael Thomas back? I'll go yes or no, 1, 2, 3.
Pete, I think he might end up being the scapegoat, even though our offense finished, you know, pretty strong. I would say he probably will be back. I think AK will be back. He's too valuable of a piece. That while our offense went, you know, did some good things, I still think he's a difference maker, big time difference maker. Michael Thomas, I would love to have him back, a veteran presence, because we've got a lot of young guys. I don't know that he comes back just based on money. Marshawn Lattimore, I don't know if he comes back based on money. I mean, there's a bunch of guys I could keep going, but we gotta get out of here, man.
We got to get out of here. You're right, Lance. Amazing insight as always. Again, I wish we could just dedicate the whole half hour to you. Thank you so much for your amazing insight and an amazing analysis.
Thanks, guys. I wear my heart on my sleeve.